Eugene McCarthy, who was sort of an odd duck politically, libertarian in many ways, socialist in other ways, he said the United States cannot regain its competitive standing in the world by importing low-wage workers from other countries. On the one hand, it engenders conditions this country cannot and should not tolerate. On the other hand, in the modern age, a nation's wealth and prosperity is secured by high worker productivity and capital investment, not by the availability of low-wage labor. To hear Republicans, to hear our friend Paul Ryan come on here and talk about how the importation of poor, illiterate, low-skilled, unskilled workers into this country will expand economic growth is so utterly absurd. And he's not alone, Jeb Bush and others. It's just sad. It's sad to hear this. Now, folks, just to be perfectly blunt about these things, our prisons are filled with illegal aliens who are criminals. About 25% of the people in our prison system are foreigners, legal and illegal. Did you know that? I mean, this isn't all about importing the Ozzie and Harriet version of somebody from the third world. This is out of control. Do you know what we have on our border? Anarchy. We have brave men and women who are so completely outnumbered and their hands are tied that they cannot effectively control the border. Now, they'll tell you how much we've spent on the border, more money on the border. What does that have to do with anything? If I have a transmission in the car that doesn't work and I keep telling you how much I spent on it, but it still doesn't work, it doesn't work. I can't drive the car. The issue isn't how much they've spent in a government that spends ceaselessly. The issue is, have they secured the border? How is it that a tiny country like Israel can secure its border against terrorists and somehow we can't? The answer is, we can. But we're the subjects. We're not the citizens. And our quote-unquote representatives won't do it. They just will not do it. And what's happening now is the demographics in the country are changing so fundamentally. And we have these ethnic front groups who seek to balkanize this nation. They don't promote assimilation. That it's becoming politically more difficult to do what's actually right for the sovereignty of the nation and for the nation generally. There is an American culture. It's an American culture that embraces the Declaration of Independence and private property rights and all these things. That people flee here from their cultures that obviously don't work to escape. And yet we, through our government, through the courts, through our public school system, you name it, because the left controls all these institutions, from within we destroy our own culture, our own society, and our own system of government. We have these temporary politicians in Washington who keep pushing these massive agendas, these massive programs, entitlements, redistribution of wealth that are dragging the nation down, that are transforming this nation, that's destroying the heritage of this nation. And I'm going to make another point. I am tired of hearing people, including Republicans, trash quote-unquote white people. What is that all about? Why do they play this race game? Why do they get into this pandering? In the 1960s, when Ted Kennedy and Lyndon Johnson fundamentally altered our immigration system, an immigration system that was based on quotas from different regions of the world, different countries of the world, to create a quote-unquote balance of ethnicities, a balance of skills and backgrounds and so forth, they destroyed all of that. Because way back then, they wanted to change the makeup of the voters in this country, even though they promised they weren't doing that. And that's exactly what they did. The vast majority of people who come to this country come from the third world. Not everybody, but the vast majority. And most of those folks don't speak English. And most of those folks don't have skills that relate to what goes on in our own economy. Can they learn these things? I don't know. Our government interferes with our own homegrown citizens from learning these things. Isn't that true? Does our government promote assimilation? No. We have federal departments, this agency, that agency, and another agency, that divide us into groups. We have laws that divide us into groups. We have a census system that counts us and puts us into groups. There's no assimilation taking in this country unless it's the individual on his or her own who choose to be assimilated. But there's no effort to indoctrinate people in this country to the greatness of the American system when the President of the United States is, in fact, attacking the American system. So an appreciation for the Constitution, American history, private property rights, these things, they're not taught. They're not even shown. In fact, we have bureaucracies that go overseas for potential immigrants into this country to let them know what welfare benefits they might qualify for. The government in Washington, D.C. is very, very sick. It's very sick. The government is devouring our society. The government is devouring our culture. And so when I hear these folks on the fringes, timid as they are, putting out their white papers, talking about a little tax cut here, a little this here, folks, we're well beyond that. We are so far beyond that. We actually have Democrats with some Republicans arguing that Obamacare should apply to people who aren't even citizens in this country, people who came here illegally. I mean, do we all believe in national suicide? Is that what we all want? And so these people who do not respect our heritage, the American heritage, our Constitution, the purpose of our founding, liberty, and are consumed with ever centralizing the federal government, making it more and more powerful, who dismiss as conspiracy nuts and kooks what goes on with this NSA data mining, what goes on at the IRS, what goes on at this department and that department, another department, and now the FBI director admits, yes, there's drones up there. Just for some surveillance, you know. We're still working out the chinks here. What is this that's happening to this country? What is it? What have we become? What are we becoming? And what is this attack on white people? This has always amazed me. First of all, what do we mean by white people? Do white people walk around thinking about, I'm a white guy? No, you don't. Even white people have all kinds of different backgrounds, come from different parts of the world, different beliefs, different ideologies, different experiences, just like black people and brown people and yellow people and red people and albinos and whatever else is out there. My point is, the left, which controls the federal government and basically drives the Republican Party, let's be honest, the left drives the Republican Party. It shows minimal resistance. They embrace the New Deal just as strongly as the Democrats do, pretty much. But the fact is, this is an attack. Even the way these folks talk, and I'm including people like Lindsey Graham and Jeb Bush and Karl Rove, even the way they talk about this society is a complete rejection of our history. It really is. It truly is. And it's very frustrating. You're going to have 46 million foreigners in this country in 20 years on top of 300 million people. You're going to have 46 million when the nation is on the brink of bankruptcy, when the welfare state is imploding. Why are we doing this to ourselves? Have you voted for this? Do you support this? Of course you don't. You know what's amazing about this, too, if you think about it? The people who are in power are really a handful of people. Aside from the massive bureaucracy, the fourth branch of government, as I call it, the administrative state, 100 members of the Senate, 435 members of the House, a president and a vice president. Yes, various cabinet officers and so forth, but this isn't even 1,000 people. You have 1,000 federal judges. So we're talking about people in the top echelons of power, less than 2,000, far less than 2,000, driving the direction of this nation. And more than half of them aren't elected. Something's wrong with this when we don't have recourse. No, I'm not one of these people who believes in plebiscites and majoritarianism, but that's not the point. You don't have to believe in those things to believe that this is out of control, completely out of whack. You might say, this is how our system's set up. The problem is, the government is doing things, the federal government, that the Constitution prohibits. And so to say that you vote for these things, you can't vote for these things. The Constitution is the Constitution. When we have elections, they're not elections to overturn the Constitution. They're not elections to amend it or rewrite it or change it in any way. They're elections for individuals who take an oath to follow the Constitution. So you can't say, well, these politicians, they represent the will of the people. It doesn't matter if they represent the will of the people. They still have to operate within the confines of the Constitution. Otherwise, we have a breakdown. And ladies and gentlemen, we have a breakdown. We have a breakdown. Listen to the entire debate on this immigration issue. It's what's in the best interest of whom? 11 million people who are here illegally, not the 300 million citizens or legal immigrants. What kind of an argument is that? And then when we say secure the border for the American people, secure the border from terrorists, from drug dealers, from people who come in here who aren't invited in here or who won't get in line, what do they tell us? They're not going to do it. They won't do it. They won't do it, whether it's George W. Bush or whether it's Barack Obama. They will not do it. Which tells you what? You're the subject. You're not the citizen. That's what it tells you, that the system is broken. And then when you question it, oh, how can you hate your government and not love your country? I would say those who continue to promote a government like this hate their country.